We're going to have a little transition here. Normally, Nancy is playing the organ during the baptism, but for some reason, she's not today, and she needs to get a little bit better sight. I tell you what, Nancy, why don't you come sit right there in my seat right there so you can see better, and I tell you, nobody would even bother you if you stood to see, and you need to see this grandbaby being baptized this morning. What a wonderful way to begin our day today. We have two that have placed their faith, full faith, in trust in Jesus Christ as their Lord and their Savior. I want to begin by reading a very familiar passage, but I always say, don't let the familiarity of it cause you to lose the significance of it. When Jesus was being baptized, it says in Matthew chapter 3, then Jesus arrived from the Galilee at the Jordan, coming to John to be baptized by him. But John tried to prevent him, saying, I have need to be baptized by you, and do you come to me? Can't you understand what John the Baptist was saying there? But Jesus answering said to him, permit it at this time, for in this way it is fitting for us to fulfill all righteousness. Then he permitted him. And after being baptized, Jesus went up immediately from the water, and behold, the heavens were opened, and he saw the Spirit of God descending as a dove and coming upon him. And behold, a voice out of the heavens saying, this is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased. I believe with all of my heart that the Lord Jesus is here today. And I believe that as these two come up out of the water of baptism, I believe that the Father is saying, that's my son, or that's my daughter, in whom I am well pleased. Let's go to the Lord in prayer and pray for these two, and then we'll follow through with believers' baptism. Father, I thank you, praise you today. We come to you in prayer at this time. Father, I'm so grateful for what you've done in Waylon's life. Thank you, Lord, for drawing him as a young boy so that he has his entire life to be able to serve you. Lord, I pray for children today that may need to make the same commitment that he's made to follow you. And now, even as he follows through believer's baptism, blessing today. Bless his family. Father, I thank you for Caitlin. I thank you, Lord, for saving her soul. I thank you, Lord, that you've given her the assurance of her salvation. And Father, that she can rejoice in that today. And both of them commit as being your disciples today, that they fully identify with you and who you are and what you've done and have a desire to serve you. Bless both of their families on this special day today, and bless our church family on this special time today. In Jesus' name, amen. Can you see him? All right. He's actually tall. Waylon, I want to ask you one question this morning. Have you placed your full faith and trust in Jesus Christ to be your Lord and Savior? In obedience to the command of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, and upon your public profession of faith in him, I now baptize you, my brother, in the name of the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen. Step up. All right. Very good. Great job. Great job.
You could probably swim
right back over there. They said he loves the water. Bit of height difference, huh? This is Caitlin Murphy. Caitlin, have you placed your full faith and trust in Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior? In obedience to the command of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, and upon your public profession of faith in Him, I now baptize you, my sister, in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Praise the Lord. Amen. Jerry Clower used to say, ain't God good? Amen. God is good that He saves us. There's some of you here today that need to do the same thing. God's been calling you. God's been speaking to you. God's been saying this is what you need to do. Why would you wait? I pray you'll place your full faith and trust in Jesus Christ today as your Lord and Savior. Now, in just a second here, you're going to see a little video. Our friend Bill Britt, I think some of you have already seen it. Our friend Bill Britt is advertising our Bible conference that's coming up in the way that only Bill Britt could do it. And so watch this video and be reminded of our Bible conference that's coming up. Make sure you're making your plans to be here for that. And also, I want to say this, too, before he does this, some other important news, and that is we had grandbaby number 10 yesterday. And so we're excited this morning, and I've got a picture on my phone if you'd love to see it. Actually, I've got pictures of all 10 if you'd like to see those, too. But praise God for being with our daughter Kristen and her husband and family yesterday. Annie Kate was born at noon yesterday, 7 pounds, 6 ounces, 20 and a half inches long, and we are a little bit proud. Watch this video.
Hey, word on the street is March 6, 7, 8, and 10, there's going to be an exciting event at a place called Sweetwater Baptist Church in Quitman, Louisiana. The pastor, Dr. Wilton Wall, has let this kind of get out on the street, and he wants us to share it. I'm so excited about it, I'm gonna be there. Big Papa's coming, and I'm looking forward to hearing some great preaching and listening to this wonderful music and worshiping with our Lord. So don't miss it. March 6, 7, 8, and 10, Sweetwater Baptist Church, Quitman, Louisiana. You don't want to miss this, I'm telling you. Word's getting out. People are coming. I'll see you there.
Good morning. Let's stand together, if you will. Let's begin singing Down at the Cross.
The blood of
wonderful time of singing, glorify thy name in all the earth. Psalm 86, Brother Gilbert's going to come and read for us this morning as we continue to read through the Psalms. What a great blessing this has been, and so I encourage you to follow along with him. Psalm 86, Brother Gilbert.
Psalms 86 is a prayer of David, and he's praying for mercy. As we read this, it says, bow down your ear, O Lord, hear me, for I am poor and needy. Preserve my life, for I am holy. You are my God. Save your servant who trusts in you. Be merciful to me, O Lord. For I cry to you all day long. Yes. Rejoice, the soul of your servant. For to you, O Lord, I lift up my soul. For you, Lord, are good and ready to forgive and abundant in mercy to all those who call upon you. Give ear, O Lord, to my prayer and attend to the voice of my supplications. In the day of my trouble, I will call upon you, for you will answer me. Among the gods, there is none like you, O Lord, nor are there any works like your works. All nations whom you have made shall come and worship before you, O Lord, and shall glorify your name. For you are great and do wondrous things. You alone are God. Teach me your way, O Lord. I will walk in your truth. Unite my heart to fear your name. I will praise you, O Lord, my God, with all my heart, and I will glorify your name forevermore. For great is your mercy towards me, and you have delivered my soul from the depths of Sheol. O God, the proud have risen against me, and a mob of violent men have sought my life and have not set you before them. But you, O Lord, are a God full of compassion and gracious, long-suffering and abundant in mercy and truth. O turn to me and have mercy on me. Give your strength to your servant, and save the son of your maidservant. Show me a sign for good, that those who hate me may see it and be ashamed, because you, Lord, have helped me and comforted me. Let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we come to you this morning just thanking you, Lord, for your love, your grace, and most of all for your mercy. Lord, we ask for mercy. Lord, just pray that you just be with each one of us, Lord, as we go through this day. Be with Brother Wall as he leads today. Just fill him with your Holy Spirit that he might say the things that we need to hear. Just pray, Lord, we would take this, apply it to our lives, that we might live closer to you each day. That, Lord, that everything that we do and say would be to glorify your name and your name only. We ask these things in Jesus' name for his sake. Amen.
Decisions must be made, and now I have a choice. I need your wisdom, Lord, and I need to hear your voice. I'm facing challenges, and the walls are closing in. I'm crying
They come down. I'm just tempted to let them play a minute and let the choir get down a minute. We have such an awesome God, and I think so many times we miss the opportunity to worship Him. And don't get me wrong, I don't mean singing is worship. It's part of it. But worship is when we put our priority and our focus and allow the Holy Spirit to move in with among us and just focus on Jesus Christ. Let's do that this morning. Sing this chorus with me if you will.
Glory of your name.
Father, we give you praise today because you paid it all. What a beautiful, beautiful hymn. That you paid it all for us. We owe you everything. We owe you everything that we are, everything that we have. And I pray, Father, that you would help us even as we think about that today. You would help us to focus in your word and not be thinking about, not dishonoring your word in this time by thinking about the other things that we've got to do today or this week. But that we would hear the word, because Satan does not want us to hear the word. He does not want us to hear this passage today. So I pray that we will hear. I pray that we will listen. I pray that we will respond in the way that we need to today. Thank you for what you've already done in this service today. And now may you be glorified in the word that's shared. In Jesus' name, amen. Did you notice a while ago, the choir sang basically the same thing that the psalmist wrote in Psalm 86. You might not have noticed that, but Psalm 86, what Brother Gilbert read a while ago, coincided just like that with what the choir sang. Now, I guarantee you, nobody planned it that way. When we set up Psalm 86 to be read today, we did not set it up that way. And when they prepared to sing, they were not preparing to sing what Psalm 86 said. Isn't it neat to be a part of what God does and just see how he puts things together? Well, I want you to take your Bibles and turn to Luke chapter 4. Luke chapter 4. And we're going to be thinking about a subject today that the devil doesn't want you to hear. By the way, anybody been under the attack of the enemy this week? If you're a believer and you're seeking the Lord, there's going to be times of attack. You can see that the devil doesn't mess with folks that aren't doing anything. If we're not doing anything, we're sitting back, he leaves us alone. But if we personally, individually, are trying to serve the Lord, the devil doesn't like it. We as a church trying to do the right things, the devil doesn't like that. So he's going to attack the church. He'll attack your family. He'll attack you individually. And certainly, listen to me, if he attacked Jesus, he's going to attack us. Jesus said the same thing, didn't he? He said, if they come after me, they're going to come after you. So I want us to look at this great passage today in Luke chapter 4. We continue our study of the Gospel of Luke. We look at Luke chapter 4, beginning with verse 31. Would you stand in honor to the Word of God? And we're going to read through the end of the chapter. Luke chapter 4, beginning with verse 31, it says, "And then he went down to Capernaum." He had been in Nazareth, remember? He had preached in his hometown. He had preached in what you might say his home church. And the home folk did not respond very well to his preaching. They wanted a miracle, didn't they? They got one. They got a miracle. They got a miracle in that they tried to kill him and he slipped right away from them. Supernaturally. But now he moves on down to Capernaum. He went down to Capernaum, a city of Galilee, was teaching them on the Sabbaths. And they were astonished at his teaching, for his word was with authority. Now in the synagogue there was a man who had a spirit of an unclean demon. And he cried out with a loud voice, saying, "Let us alone. What have we done with you, Jesus of Nazareth? Did you come to destroy us? I know who you are, the Holy One of God." But Jesus rebuking him, saying, "Be quiet and come out of him." And when the demon had thrown him in their midst, it came out of him and did not hurt him. And they were all amazed and spoke among themselves, saying, "What a word is this? For with authority and power he commands the unclean spirits, and they come out." And the report about him went out into every place in the surrounding region. Now he arose from the synagogue and entered Simon's house, but Simon's wife's mother was sick with a high fever. And they made a request of him concerning her. And so he stood over her and rebuked the fever, and it left her. And immediately she arose and served them. When the sun was setting, all those who had any of those that were sick with various diseases brought them to him, and he laid his hands upon them, every one of them, and he healed them. And demons also came out of many, crying out and saying, "You are the Christ, the Son of God." And he, rebuking them, did not allow them to speak, for they knew that he was the Christ. Now when it was day, he departed and went into a deserted place, and the crowd sought him and came to him and tried to keep him from leaving them. But he said, "I must preach the kingdom of God to the other cities also, because for this purpose I have been sent." And he was preaching in the synagogues of Galilee. You may be seated. The great C.S. Lewis said it this way. He said, "There are two equal and opposite errors in which human beings make when it comes to demons. One is to not believe in their existence. The other is to have an unhealthy interest in them." Two extremes. Now, it seems like to me, from what I can kind of tell today, in our post-Christian culture, that we lean heavily toward the latter. There is an unhealthy interest in the demonic. Today, your homes are flooded with television shows that have a demonic theme. Our theaters are flooded today, and also your homes, flooded with movies that have a demonic theme. Cartoons are even included in that today. Parents and grandparents, you better be very careful about what you're allowing your children or your grandchildren to watch. You think, well, they're watching Disney, it's okay. Have you noticed Disney lately? I think it's okay for them to be able to sit there and to absorb all of those things. We live in a day where there's a flood of books, there's a flood of movies, there's a flood of cartoons. And I will tell you this, what I think. I think that if Christians would stop buying them, it would probably stop. If Christians would quit going to movies that have a demonic theme, might help matters. Hello, anybody here? But we are part of the ones that endorse that. We've introduced into our world, being introduced into our world, the world of wizards, the world of spirits. Just again, be careful about the cartoons that are endorsing wizards and spirits and alien beings. I want you to understand what Ephesians 4:27 says. Ephesians 4:27 says, "Do not give place to the devil." Do not give him wiggle room. Do not give him an inch. If you give him an inch, he's going to take more than that. We should never, ever partake in films or movies or shows or books that make light of the demonic and make it entertaining. We should never do that. And probably today, let's be honest, there needs to be some repenting of that. There probably needs to be some repenting when we say, well, we just let it go because it's no big deal. It's a big deal. Many Christians today are preoccupied on the other side of that, are preoccupied with demons and saying that everything and anything that happens in their life that's not positive comes from demons. Sometimes we understand, need to understand that what happens in our life is a part of being a part of a fallen world. That there's going to be things that are going to happen in our life as a result of the fall of man, that it is living in this world. But we need to also remember something else, and that is that believers, if you have placed your faith and trust in the Lord Jesus Christ and He is your Lord and your Savior, you cannot be possessed of a demon. You hear, well, that dude, that church member's possessed. Well, that church member must be a lost church member. Because if you're saved, the Holy Spirit indwells you, the Bible says, right? The Holy Spirit moves in, and there's no room for the devil to move in. Now, on the other hand, the devil can oppress you. He can frustrate you. He can discourage you. He will come against you. He will fire his darts against you in opposition to you. And so believers need to understand that we can be oppressed and we need to guard against them and we need to pray a barrier against them, especially protecting our homes. Because the very area that he wanted to have influence more than any other area is in your marriage. He wants to have the greatest influence in your marriage. He wants to influence your children. He wants to harm your children, especially those kids of yours that don't know the Lord yet, haven't been saved yet. I'm telling you, listen to me, he's coming after them. And so when's the last time you prayed a hedge around your home? Prayed a hedge around your family? What about this? What about going throughout your home and just praying over your home? Praying over your property, praying over your church, because I'm telling you something, the devil doesn't like Sweetwater Baptist Church. What he would like to do is to destroy the church. He wants to destroy us. That's his business. That's what he wants to do. Psalm 51:10 says, I think this would be a great verse for us to pray all the time. And I heard somebody talking about how they prayed this chapter all the time in a funeral this past Friday. Psalm 51:10 says, create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a steadfast spirit within me. That ought to be our prayer. When we wake up in the morning, God created me a clean heart. We can't be clean if we're dabbling. We can't be clean if we're dabbling with the enemy. If we're playing around with the enemy, if we're thinking, well, we're going to have fun with the enemy, you can't have a clean heart that way. Also, Philippians 4:8 says, finally, with men whatsoever things are true and noble and just and pure and lovely and good report and of praiseworthy and virtuous, meditate on those things. You see, the attack that's going on and many times against us is the attack of the mind. The oppression of the mind coming against you and your thoughts. Have you noticed how dirty, rotten, nasty our thoughts get sometimes? That's the enemy. So we pray over those things. We constantly meditate upon those things that are right. Listen to me. That means you're in the Word of God. You're meditating upon the Word of God. You're praying over the Word of God. You're reading a Psalm 51 like David quoted. Like he shared in his life. Now, there's no confusion in the Bible regarding who the devil is. There's no confusion in the Bible regarding Satan and his demons. They were holy angels. Lucifer was the highest ranking angel of all. You can go back and you can study Ezekiel 28. You can study Isaiah chapter 14. They lived in heaven. There they in heaven, they served God until this prideful leader, Lucifer, led a rebellion against God, and one third of all the angels followed him. I shared this past Wednesday night that we're talking in Revelation. The good news of that is this. The good news is that two thirds of the angels didn't. So you got two thirds of holy angels that are fighting against one third of the demonic, and of course, beyond all the angels' power, we have the power of God on our side. And so we have an understanding of the enemy. There's no confusion about who he is and what the Bible says. But as a result of their pride, they were cast out of heaven. However, I want you to understand something, that according to Job and according to Revelation and other places, they still have access. Hello? They still have access to heaven. Did Lucifer, did he or did he not go before the Lord regarding Job? You see in Revelation that there's going to be a final time in Revelation chapter 12 that if you want to hear about this, you come in, it'll be a couple of weeks because I'm going to see a grandbaby on Wednesday, but that in Revelation 12 it talks about Satan being finally and completely kicked out of heaven. No access, whatever. The war in heaven won. He still has access. But at the end of the great tribulation, they will be finally cast out of heaven by Michael and the holy angels. The purpose of demons, what is their reason for existence? Their purpose is to thwart the purposes of God. They are behind every world system that opposes God. They are behind everything that tries to dominate our lives and that does not, and those things that do not belong to God. They are behind all of that. Jesus declared in John 8:44, he says that all unbelievers belong to Satan. If you're here today and you have never trusted Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, the Bible says in John 8:44, you belong to him. You belong to the enemy. Let me just read it. It says, you are of your father the devil, and the desires of your father you want to do. He was a murderer from the beginning, does not stand in the truth, because there is no truth in him. When he speaks a lie, he speaks from his own resources, for he is a liar and he is the father of lies. Now, Janice Kent Wall, my mother said one time to me, she said, you're never more like the devil, Wilton, than when you lie. I've always remembered that. Because he is the father of lies. When we don't tell the truth, we're just acting like him. We're just being like the devil. Well, there's so many places in the scripture where we find the demons working. But one of those places was in particular in the early part of Genesis. In Genesis, they possessed fallen men. It says that the demons possessed men and they cohabited with women. This was prior to the flood. The demons cohabited with women and they created a demonic human race. But then what did God do in response to that? Somebody help me. What did God do in response to that? He, in response to that, had the flood. He said that all things that were going on in the world, all except for one family, all things were bad, all things were evil. And so he destroyed the world by the flood. All but Noah and his family. The New Testament, though. To get over to the New Testament, you want to know, when am I ever going to get my outline? This is introduction. You know how my introductions go. But in the New Testament, they made a supreme assault. They made a supreme assault on Jesus. You see them everywhere. They assaulted the apostles, didn't they? In the early church, they came after them. Let me help you to understand that the demons are real, the demons are personal, the demons are fallen spirits wholly committed to destroying you, wholly committed to total wickedness. Now, Luke is going to introduce a new theme now. What he's been doing up until this time, he's been sharing for us in these first four chapters up to this point, the credentials of Jesus, that Jesus is the Son of God. And you've got all these different witnesses that we've looked at that have proclaimed that who Jesus is and that he's the Son of God. And now what he's going to do, he's going to share with us the power and the authority of Jesus. The power and the authority of Jesus in the spiritual realm that we're talking about now, but also in the physical realm. We're going to look at two parts, the spiritual realm and the physical realm we're going to consider today. We will see his authority. Jesus has complete authority over the demons. Jesus has complete authority over all religion. He has complete authority over disease and nature and even death. And Luke is going to describe that for us. Man, you got a wonderful time coming up as we look at the Gospel of Luke. Here's something else about the evil spirits. They knew why Jesus had come. They knew why Jesus had come. You see, Lucifer, pretty smart. Lucifer knows why Jesus had come. They knew their fate. Matthew 25:41, listen, this is what Jesus said. Then he will say to those on the left hand, depart from me, you cursed, into the everlasting fire, prepared for the devil and his angels. Listen to me. If you go to hell because you've rejected Christ, you go to the place that was designed for the devil and his angels. And so they know what their ultimate end is going to be. And they want to take as many souls to hell with them as they can. There has been an forever, throughout all the ages, one major battle going on. Drag as many people to hell as possible. That's their goal. And for us as believers, following after the Lord, where he says, I must go about preaching. I've been sent. I must go. I want you to understand that we, because we follow him, we have been sent and we must go. Sharing the gospel of Jesus everywhere that we go. And so, the first thing, notice his authority over the demons. His authority over the demons. Now, what did they fear? What did they fear? According to these verses, they feared his preaching. They feared his teaching. Listen to me. The devil still fears gospel preaching. That's why he has so many people in the pulpits today that don't preach the gospel. He has led them astray to preaching their philosophy about life, their views, versus preaching the word. The enemy hates the preaching of the word of God. They feared his preaching. Jesus was above all else a preacher. Listen, Matthew 4:17. Jot these verses down. Matthew 4:17. From that time, Jesus began to preach and say to them, repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. That was what he was about. Matthew 11:1 says, now it came to pass when Jesus finished commanding his 12 disciples that he departed from there to teach and to preach in their cities. It was the desire of Jesus to carry out the mission that the Father had given to him, and that message and that mission was to preach. Luke 8:1 says, now it came to pass afterward that he went through every city and every village preaching and bringing the glad tidings of the kingdom of God. And watch this, and the 12 were with him. That means he's teaching them by hands-on practice. He's showing them how to teach. He's showing them how to preach. He's showing them how to be about this work. Now listen again, folks, that's a work that's been given to us. Some people will say today, why are you so busy about going on missions and doing evangelism and so forth? I'll tell you why. It's because there's something that Jesus said, that there is a great commission and that we're to go to all the world and we're to be teaching and baptizing in the name of the Father, making disciples in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. That's our role. That's our job. That's the very thing that Satan wants to keep us from doing, whether it's here locally, here in our state, here in our nation, here around the world. The Lord's example underscores the importance of preaching even today. 1 Corinthians 1:18 says, for the preaching of the cross is to them that perish foolishness, but unto those of us that are saved, it is the power of God. Now, how many of you would say that the preaching of the cross drew you to Jesus? I'll be one of those. That the preaching of the cross, I am thankful that I grew up in a place where there were preachers that were unashamed in preaching the cross of Jesus Christ. They were unashamed to sing that Jesus paid it all. They were unashamed of that message. Folks, I want to tell you, it is the preaching of the cross that draws people to Christ. It is the power of God in our lives. Jesus was teaching them on the Sabbath, it says. And they were amazed at his teaching. Why? Because he taught unlike the others. You got the Pharisees that got up there, and they were probably pretty dull. And they lacked authority. But when he preached, when he taught, they knew there's something different. There's something different. We know that the Spirit of God was all over him. And he preached, they were amazed at his teaching because his preaching was characterized in this way. His preaching was characterized, the preaching of Jesus was powerful. The preaching of Jesus was true. It was pure. It was delivered with convicting force of the Holy Spirit. And it was clear. It was clear. It was clear, listen to me, so that the children would be able to understand, but that on the other hand, the theologians, I was talking about this morning with somebody, the theologians can swim around in the truth and never find the bottom. That's how great it is. But listen, and so when he taught, that was so characteristic of his teaching in the synagogue that day, though. As Jesus is preaching, all of a sudden, a demon-possessed man speaks up, cries out. Now, I want to tell you that demon possession was widespread during the earthly ministry of Jesus and during the early church. I believe this. I believe that right now we're seeing a dramatic increase in demonic activity. Why? Why? They were here working when Jesus was here. Listen to me. They know he's coming back soon. And so there's a raging battle that is happening now, and it will continue to crescendo until the time we get into the great tribulation. The Lord's preaching unnerved them, unnerved the demons. He cried out during the message. You just imagine that. As Jesus preached, he says, "I've come to set people free." And that demon cried out. He had possessed that man. That demon cried out. And you know what hit the demon? The dreaded doom hit that demon. And he cried out. What did he say? "Let us alone. Leave me be." Have you ever said that to God, by the way? "Just leave me alone, God. I want to do what I want to do." We know where that comes from, don't we? But he says here, "Leave me alone. Why are you attacking us?" You see, demons like to hide and abide in lost religious people. That's a safe place for them to abide in the lost religious people. And disguise themselves as light. In other words, "Hey, I'm in church. I'm religious. I'm going through the motions here. Hey, look at me, how good I look." A person desperately deceived. And now with Jesus preaching, this guy understands that their cover's been blown. Because he can look right at him and know. Jesus looked right at that man and he knew what was going on. And this guy was terrified because he knew who Jesus was and what Jesus' purpose was. Let me remind you this. 1 John 3:8 says this: "He who sins is of the devil, for the devil has sinned from the beginning. For this purpose, the Son of God was manifested." This is why the Son of God was manifested: that he might destroy the works of the devil. Why did Jesus come? Destroy the works of the devil. Destroy the works of the devil. That word "destroy," that means to ruin or to bring to nothing or to bring to an end. And isn't that wonderful news for us today? And if you're a believer, that's wonderful news. He's come and he says, "I'm going to bring it all to an end. I'm going to once and for all destroy the enemy and put him away forever." They knew what their sentence would be. They knew that during the millennial reign of Christ, 1,000 years, that they're going to be sentenced to the abyss for 1,000 years. They know that they're going to be ultimately sentenced to the lake of fire where they'll spend forever and ever. But then something else they feared. They feared his virtue. Verse 34, they feared his virtue. "Let us alone. What have we done with you, Jesus of Nazareth? Did you come to destroy us? I know who you are. I know who you are, the Holy One of God." They feared his virtue. Unlike the atheists today, unlike the liberal theologians today, unlike the backslidden believers today, they know that Jesus is holy. They feared his holiness. Now, if God's people are fearful in his presence, which, by the way, we should be. Hello? We should be fearful in his presence. I mean, in awe and respect and honor of his presence. Can you imagine how terrifying it must be for a demon to be in the presence of holiness? They feared his virtue. Now, Jesus did not need their testimony. In fact, Jesus didn't want their testimony. So he silenced them when they affirmed his true identity. Because true believers have Christ living in them. Demons can fear those believers also, because Christ lives in us. But Jesus said, look, I don't need you. I don't want your testimony. Shut up. Be quiet. And they had to be quiet. And you know why? Because they were going to proclaim him as the Messiah, and it wasn't time. Listen to me. Jesus, the whole time he was in here, who's in charge? Jesus. He said, it's not the time now. It will be the time later on, but you're not going to rush me. You're not going to get ahead of me. They feared his virtue. They feared his sovereignty. They feared his sovereignty. That he was in full power and full control. Jesus spoke and the demons had no choice but to obey. They had no choice. This demon reluctantly came out of the man, did him no harm because Jesus protected him. And the report of the fact that this demon came out of him would spread like wildfire. Can you imagine? Can you imagine how that would spread? It would spread like wildfire here, wouldn't it? But then I want you to notice something else, and I'm trying to hurry. His authority over sickness. He not only had authority over the demons, he had authority over sickness. Jesus left there, it says here, and I'm not going to take much time because we'll follow this up next time. But Jesus went to Simon Peter's house, and his mother-in-law was sick. They said, listen to me. They said, listen to me. Come over here and pray over mama-in-law. And so Jesus goes over there, listen, and what he does, he spoke. He spoke and he rebuked the fever, and the fever had no choice, just like the devil. It had to come out. So he speaks, he rebukes the fever. He has authority over sickness. Listen, he did then and he still does. And we can believe, we can trust in that he has authority over sickness. And it says in verse 40 and 41, he healed all of those who came to him. Everybody got healed when they came to him. And here's the last thing. He returned to his primary mission after that. Listen, the next day, he goes out and he gets alone. What do you think he's doing? What do you think he's doing? After he's healed the mother-in-law. Next day, he done preached. That next day, he goes out. He's by himself. What in the world do you think he's doing? He's praying. What do you do first thing in the morning? How much time do we spend with the Father? And yet, Jesus goes out, spends time with the Father. And then they come hunting him down. And they want more miracles. And this is what Jesus said. He returned to his primary mission, preaching. My primary mission is to preach. So he goes on to the other cities there in Galilee and continues to preach. I want to close with this great song that you've heard me quote it many times. We've sang it numerous times here in church. It's an old hymn. But when I was doing this, I said, they've heard me do this before, and they don't want to hear it again, but I'm going to do it again anyway. It's a song written by Martin Luther. This is what it says. I want you to pay close attention to the words of this song. Don't worry, I'm not going to try to sing it. A mighty fortress is our God. Don't get too excited now. A bulwark never failing. Our helper, he amid the flood of mortal ills prevailing. For still our ancient foe doth seek to work us woe. His craft and power are great, and armed with cruel hate, on earth is not his equal. Did we in our own strength confide, our striving would be losing. We're not the right man on our side. The man of God's own choosing does ask who that may be. Christ Jesus, it is he. Lord Sabaoth, his name. From age to age the same, and he must win the battle. And though this world with devils filled should threaten to undo us, we will not fear, for God hath willed his truth to triumph through us. The prince of darkness grim, we tremble not for him. His rage we can endure, for lo, his doom is sure, and one little word shall fail him. That word above all earthly powers, no thanks to them abideth. The Spirit and the gifts are ours. Through him with us sighteth. Let goods and kindred go. This mortal life also, this body, they may kill. But God's truth abideth still. His kingdom is forever and ever and ever and ever. Amen and amen. Let's pray together. Father, thank you for the power of your word today, reminding us that we have victory over the enemy. As you displayed this victory, Lord, we understand that if you live in us, there's a power in us that overcomes the enemy. It's not us. It's not anything that we have, Lord, but we have the Holy Spirit of God in us. Father, I pray today that we would confess before you, that we would repent before you of the times that we have allowed the devil an inch. When we've opened up our lives and opened up our homes and opened up our families to his destructive powers. Lord, today I pray for parents. I pray for grandparents. I pray for us to pray over our homes, to pray over our children, to pray over our marriages, to pray a hedge of protection around them, oh God. And Lord, I pray today right now in my own family, Lord. Lord, I pray for my kids as they raise their kids. God, help them to live for you in front of them. And then, Lord, I pray for my grandchildren. Lord, I pray for every one of them. I pray for their soul today. God, would you save them? Oh, God, save them. Protect them from the enemy. Help me as a grandfather and as a father to be that right example in front of them. And, Lord, I pray for all of us in this building today. I pray that we would be willing to fall on our face before you and cry out to you, God, who provides the victory. Oh, Lord Jesus, thank you for this wonderful passage. Now help us.